That's all right.
Thank you.
Yes. So, if we see the archives of 1961, or since 1961, we will see that the contacts of the Soviet embassy with the representatives of the Italian government had considerably increased. And Semyon Kozarev, who was the ambassador, Soviet ambassador to Rome, reported to Moscow that the Italians were looking for a counterweight to a probable Franco-German bloc. In the midst of the Cuban crisis of 1962, Fanfani informed the Soviet ambassador about his message to Kennedy with a proposal to remove 30 Jupiter missiles from the territory of Puglia in order to force Khrushchev to remove Soviet missiles from Cuba. Khrushchev expressed understanding of the position of Rome, calling such position reasonable. And in general, in Moscow, they started to call Fanfani's policy as active neutralism. Since Italy, without breaking away from the West, served as a bridge between West and East. Yet Fanfani annoyed with Moscow, and he criticized Moscow politics because of the relations of Moscow with the Italian communists. He urged the Soviet leaders to stop financial assistance to the Italian communists, which, I quote his words, Italian communists were not so loyal friends of the United States, of the Soviet Union, as they pretend to be. But nevertheless, Italian-Soviet relations developed quite successfully. First of all, as I told you, in the economic field. And the Soviet side repeatedly pointed to the abnormality of such situation, speaking in favor of intensifying political cooperation, not only cooperation in the economic field, but also in the policy field. Indeed, in 1972, Giulio Andreotti and Alexei Kosygin, our prime minister in those times, they signed the protocol of consultations, actually the first post-war document of a purely political nature. And this meant intensive consultations on the main international problems, in the words of the protocol, on the main international problems of mutual interest and on issues relating to bilateral relations. Then we see the time of Gorbachev perestroika and many reforms of an inefficient socialist system, and everything received an enthusiastic support by the majority of Italians. The Italian companies aspired to a greater openness to the Italian goods of the enormous Soviet market. And the Italian communists welcomed Gorbachev's ideas so familiar to the Euro communism, as you know, this was the new ideology of the Italian Communist Party. Also, the Vatican noted with satisfaction that the new leaders of the Soviet Union rejected state atheism. And in 1989, the Holy See reached an agreement with Gorbachev on establishing official relations with the Soviet Union. Along with the collapse of the Soviet Union and of the bipolar system, Italy's political system also began to crumble. The fact is that during, just I will say some words about Italy, the fact is that during the post-war decades, only two Italian parties, Christian Democratic Party and the Communist Party, the parties which used to win the majority of votes. However, during the Cold War, the communists, closely connected to the Soviet Union, had no chance to come to power. And nevertheless, their Eurocommunism and the change, very profound change in their ideology, considerable forces in Italy and in the West didn't accept such prospect. And the so-called government of Compromesso Storico, after the assassination of Aldo Moro in 1978, appeared absolutely unfeasible, such government. But I would say that also the Soviet leaders were quite skeptical about such a government, probably because Enrico Berlinguer, head of the Italian Communist Party, sharply criticized the Soviet party's state system, the Soviet policy, and declared his loyalty to NATO. Well, in a sense, during the Cold War, Italy became a kind of political borderline between the two blocs. Thus, unlike other democracies in Western Europe, in Italy, the political divide passed not between left and right, but between communists and anti-communist parties. So political experts defined such a situation as imperfect bipartisanship, or they spoke about polarized pluralism. And all the Italian political system was considered to be an imperfect or blocked democracy. But by the early 90s, old parties disappeared and Italy embarked the path of so-called perfect democracy by introducing a new electoral system, majority system, and from 1994 onwards, the center-right coalition formed the governments, and then they changed such position with the left wing. With the center-left coalition. Italy became one of the first countries to recognize the new Russia, born in 1991, and recognized that such new Russia was a country successor of the Soviet Union. So we will see the development of our bilateral relations also very, very good relations. In 1994, the conclusion of the Russo-Italian Treaty of Friendship and Cooperation actually provided a firm legal basis to our bilateral relations. And 2 years later, in 1996, Susanna Agnelli, then Italian foreign minister, noted, and I quote, that Russia is a fundamental factor of stability on the European continent, and that Italy will contribute to stabilization processes in Russia and will promote the development of relations between Russia and the European Union. And the Premier Berlusconi put much effort in order to help Russia join G7 group. In 1996, also the Intergovernmental Agreement on Cooperation in the Defense Sector was signed with Italy. And it provided for periodic joint naval exercises, which were successfully performed in 2004 and then in 2010. In 2001, the two countries deemed it necessary to adopt a joint declaration on cooperation in the fight against those financing international terror, those who financed international terrorism. Italian diplomacy actively favored strengthening of NATO-Russia relations when in 2002, heads of state and government of NATO member countries and of Russia gathered at Pratica di Mare Air Force Base near Rome. And in the same year, Russia and Italy established a direct line of communication between Kremlin and Palazzo Chigi. Both sides paid special attention to the so-called Italian industrial districts. So did they did a joint committee for the startup of industrial districts in Russia on the model of the Italian districts. And such system became operational in 2003. In 2008, it was the Italian government that called upon the transatlantic community and the European Union to face the crisis between Georgia and Russia with a sense of balance. Later, the declassified correspondence between the United States Embassy in Rome and the State Department made it clear that Washington wasn't very happy with the Italian attitude. And the mass media were also suspicious that friendly relations between Berlusconi and Putin would split the Western alliance. The Russo-Italian relations received a new impulse in May 2010, when strategic consultations took place in Rome and a regular meeting of both Italian and Russian foreign and defense ministers. They started in the 2+2 format, ministers of foreign affairs and ministers of defense. In 2013, Kremlin appreciated Italian claim to promote a strategic partnership between Russia and NATO. Italy was also favorable toward a Russian intention to create the Euro-Asiatic Economic Union. And Italy considered it as an important element of the European Common Economic Space, as well as such favorable attitude was toward a blueprint to work out a new framework of security in the Euro-Atlantic area. The Italian government also shared the concern regarding the missile defense shield in Europe, and the Italian diplomats shared the aspiration of the Russian authorities to abolish visas for travel in Europe. If we read the Farnesina official site in 2018, it reads, I quote, "Relations between Italy and Russia have remained intense and positive, even in a delicate phase characterized by a regime of restrictive measures imposed on Moscow by the European Union and by the main Western partners as consequences for the serious events that have taken place in Ukraine since 2014. Italy has always considered such sanctions necessary and has recognized that obvious Russian responsibility. There was the obvious Russian responsibility with regard to the illegitimate annexation of Crimea and the destabilization in Donbas. But nevertheless, Italy deemed it necessary to maintain a constructive dialogue with the Russian Federation. Indeed, following the events of 2014, the events in Ukraine, high Italian dignitaries declared that sanctions wouldn't solve the problem. Matteo Renzi, those time Italian prime minister and head of the Democratic Party, in spring 2015, was the first high-ranking politician to visit Moscow and to invite Putin to Italy. Other mutual visits followed shortly. And for example, I liked very much the speech by Matteo Renzi at Humboldt University in Berlin. And he said, I quote, "The positioning of Europe as a bulwark against Russia is a political mistake, misinterpretation of history, and a cultural crime." He reaffirmed relentlessly the Italian stance against automatically prolonging those sanctions. The other leader of Italy, Federica Mogherini, former Italian Minister of Foreign Affairs and later High Representative of the European Union for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy, she also emphasized that the anti-Russian sanctions were of no use for solving problems. And she reported to the Foreign Affairs Council about relations with Russia, and she pointed out the future necessity to reflect on the desirability and feasibility of a new framework for European Union and Russia relations. And the necessity of resumption of common steps toward visa-free short-term travel, as well as the resumption of the EU-Russia summits. In 2016, a Russian-Italian interministerial group faced was set up in order to face new challenges and threats. And the new Italian yellow-green government supported such an attitude just as well. For example, Giuseppe Conte, head of the government, at the press conference with the US President Trump, declared that sanctions against Russia cannot be eternal, and it would be positive to make Russia return to the G8 format. Also, Matteo Salvini, head of the League Party and deputy prime minister in those times, in his interview to the Washington Post about Russia's right to annex Crimea, even declared that there are some historically Russian zones with Russian culture and traditions which legitimately belong to the Russian Federation. However, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of that government, Enzo Moavero Milanese, he immediately argued against such statement. Given the negative impact of Western sanctions imposed on Russian business and the Russian counter-sanctions on the Italian business, the most affected Italian regions as Veneto, Liguria, Lombardia, and Toscana, they called on the government to pursue the policy of lifting sanctions. And the Italian businessmen in Moscow established Confindustria Russia and decided, in order to avoid sanctions, to set up joint ventures to replace the brand made in Italy by a new brand made with Russia. At the 2017 press conference with the Italian President Sergio Mattarella, President Putin reaffirmed Italy is one of the most important European partners of the Russian Federation. And our intense interaction has been a success in all directions. Even the position of Russia and Italy on world politics are close or identical. And Putin expressed his opinion that Russo-Italian relations could serve as example of collaboration with other European states, as well as with the European Union as a whole. And it was no surprise that the Financial Times in 2014 noted that governments that want to get tough on the Kremlin see Italy as the major impediment to toughening anti-Russian sanctions. In early 2018, shortly before the Italian parliamentary elections, Matteo Salvini, head of the League Party, promised to lift sanctions on Russia. Moreover, his campaign was part of the same claims made by other Eurosceptic parties in Europe, which Salvini considered his allies. And such attitude was shared also by President Trump. And Trump's far-right emissary, Steve Bannon, said that he had gone to Italy to forge an international of populist movements. Moscow was, in a sense, enthusiastic about the electoral campaign of Salvini's League, and many conservative Russian politicians willingly shared Salvini's and Bannon's allegations that foreign powers, foreign capital, and foreign media were depriving the Italian people of their sovereignty. However, on his return from the United States after the elections, Giuseppe Conte, head of the new coalition government, composed of the representatives also of the Five Stars movement, admitted that sanctions can disappear overnight. Italy tends to show low profile in the EU, where the Italian stance is still limited to a hope that sanctions might not affect Russian civil society. In 2017, Putin's party United Russia signed a deal with the Northern League to strengthen their political cooperation. In December 2017, former US Vice President and now President of the United States, Joe Biden, accused Russia of helping the opposition Five Stars Movement and Liga of the North. And in March 2018, the Italian government, led by Paolo Gentiloni, expelled two Russian diplomats after Skripal poisoning case in the United Kingdom. The party that won the 2018 election and formed a coalition government have been giving voice to the Italian industry's discontent with the sanctions on Russia. And on March 2020, after a phone call with Italian Prime Minister Giuseppe Conte, Putin ordered the Russian army to deploy medics, special disinfection vehicles, and other medical equipment to Italy, which was the European country to be most severely at the time hit by the COVID pandemic. We know that now, just I try to conclude and just to have space for our discussion. Now we have a new Italian ambassador in Moscow, Giorgio Starace. And he told recently that such negotiations about mutual reciprocal recognition of vaccines could contribute to the process of vaccination in the Russian Federation. And we know there were some visits by our foreign minister Lavrov to Italy and visits to Russia by Italian foreign minister, and the discussion about many projects by the Russian company Rosneft with the Italian companies in such a field and many others. And Rosneft now realizes joint projects with Italian companies, for example, with Eni in Mozambique and in Egypt. In December this year, in Rome, will take part meeting of Russian, Italian, Soviet on economic, industrial, and financial cooperation. So we hope that our relations will go on quite successfully. Thank you very much. I just would like to hear your questions and just to discuss something with you about our relations.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Zonova, for this very rich explanation of the system of Italian-Russian relations. I just would like to stress with point with a very, very broad historical perspective, because with our students, we have spoken and we have underlined this aspect. It's not possible to understand the current development of these relations and to properly analyze every political or geopolitical event without having the knowledge of the origin of such phenomena and the knowledge of their historical evolution. So it's not possible to really understand what happens today without knowing, and even to make hypotheses about what will happen tomorrow without knowing the past and the historical evolution of these events. So thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
To open the discussion and the let me say, the questions by students, I have two questions for you. But since we have less than 2 minutes, I think it would be better to close this conference, as we have done with the last one, and to reopen through the same link. So
okay.
I'm going to close. As I have understood, I need 2 or 3 minutes to close the registration after the close of the conference. And so see you in 2 minutes, more or less, by the same link.
Okay.
Thank you.